zone you are in. Depending on what time zone you are in, on behalf of the Center for International Human Rights, I would like to welcome you in the second session of our conversation series for this semester. Before I introduce the speaker, a couple of program notes. I hope that you will be able to join us for our remaining public events for this semester, for which more information will follow. Our two remaining events are one on Monday, November 5th, at this time, when as part of the center's year theme on human dignity in the security sector, we are going to have a presentation by Lieutenant Colonel Riffy, who was involved, she was involved in several peacekeeping missions and heavily also involved in peace and security initiatives at the United Nations, to talk about her experience in the field. And this is part of our yearly theme, which is, as I said before, human dignity in the security sector. And on Thursday, December 8th, we're going to have a panel discussion in celebration of Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and more information on this will follow. If you are not on our listserv, please contact Martina Bizzotti. Martina, if you'd like to put your email address on the chat so that she can put you on our listserv so that you can receive notices of our upcoming events. It is great pleasure to welcome my colleague, Ervand Abrahamian, a noted expert on the Middle East. He is Professor Emeritus of History at Baruch College and at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And he has written extensively on Middle Eastern issues. Among his many publications, outside Iran, Between Two Revolutions with Princeton University Press, the CIA and the Roots of Modern U.S. Relations, and the Iranian Mujahideen with Yale University Press. His book has been translated and published in many languages. He's now working on a book on the 1979 revolution in Iran. In 2011, he was elected fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. I want to thank Ervand for accepting our invitation to offer his thought on the question that is on everybody's mind, at least everybody who is watching the events unfolding in Iran. Is Iran on the verge of a revolution? Ervand will speak for about 35, 40 minutes to be followed by Q&A. I would ask you to put your questions in the chat and I will read them in the order in which they come in. Without further ado, Ervand, the floor is yours.
Thank you, George. As you all probably know, in the last 2 months, there have been extensive demonstrations, protests, most of them spontaneous, right throughout the country. Just yesterday, some 1,000 students were arrested. A large number of faculty who had supported the students were also detained. So the country obviously is in a major crisis. But the obvious question that arises, is this crisis basically a prelude to a revolution, something on the scale of what happened in the 1978-79 revolution? So I want to look at the similarities and differences between the two. First of all, before we get actually into the nitty-gritty, the word revolution has become a sponge word that's constantly used for things that are not actually revolutions. They could be revolts that fail. I mean, and revolts sometimes become revolutions, but very rarely. Revolts usually are stamped out or fizzle out. The word revolution has also been used often for national liberation movements rather than actual political social revolutions. Many of the revolutions we saw in the 20th century, late 20th century, were actually state abdications, where the state, especially in Eastern Europe, basically abdicated rather than actually saw a traditional revolution. Carlyle, in writing about the French Revolution, remarked that this such a magnitude of a revolution occurs only once in a millennium. Well, this is maybe a somewhat of an exaggeration, a millennium, but he had, I think, something that hit the nail on the head. Revolutions are not something that happen very occasionally. Marx, writing after the failure of the 1848 revolts, remarked that every time there was a protest on the continent, people in exile in England claimed that there was going to be a revolution again in Europe. And of course, there was none. There was a revolt in 1870, 1871, that failed. And it wasn't until 1917 that there was another revolution. So if you look on a large scale historical level, you only find a handful of revolutions that really can qualify as true revolutions. So you have to keep in mind that revolts are not necessarily revolutions, and most revolts failed in producing a revolution. Now, in Iran, clearly at present, there is a great deal of discontent, predominantly about economic issues. The sanctions haven't helped. There's also a considerable amount of mismanagement. The average person is economically pressured, and this is called a great deal of discontent. There is also a great deal of political discontent separate from economic. Very prevalent, and this is increasingly expanded. This regime that came into power in 1979 had a great deal of support and therefore legitimacy in the first basically referendum for the republic. It had some over 80% of the population supported the referendum. But over the course of those years, the regime has systematically itself actually cut its base. There was a cartoon actually quite soon after revolution with the regime actually cutting branches off itself. And this is dramatically increased. So now you could say the regime itself is cutting not just branches, but even roots of its own regime. So that you can see this in election times. Before, whenever there was a choice in the early years, there was a great deal of participation in the elections. In the last election, when Raisi was elected president, there was really no choice, and people voted by staying home. Instead of getting 60, 70% participation, it fell below 40%. And I think in Tehran, it was 28%. So what you find here is the narrowing of the base of the regime. And this has obviously created discontent, political discontent, separate from economic discontent. It obviously compounds it. But despite all this, basically, I would say, reason for protest, the question very much arises, is this similar to 1978-79 revolution? I think the one big difference is that in 78-79, of course, the demonstrations in the streets were not in terms of tens or 20,000s. They were actually in millions. So the participation rate in the protests were much greater. It is possible in Iran in the next few months, it'll duplicate what happened in 78. But so far, you have not had millions demonstrating. And the main difference here is that the successful revolution was successful mainly because the participation and even the leadership of the petty bourgeoisie in Iran. Now, you might raise your eyebrow at the term of petty bourgeoisie. If you find that not acceptable, one can use a more conventional term, the Bazaar Mosque Alliance. And historians of Iran have often talked about the Mosque Bazaar Alliance as crucial in creating the 1906 revolution and also the 1978-79 revolution. This bazaari, the petty bourgeoisie of the bazaar, were in fact instrumental in the 1978 revolution, not only by massive strikes, but financing of the opposition, support for the clerics, especially Khomeini. And not surprisingly, after the revolution, they actually did very well. So I would say the new elite of Iran are rooted in the petty bourgeoisie and the bazaar of the old days. There's been much talk that, you know, the bazaar is dissatisfied and the bazaar is not what it was before. But in fact, many of the powerful bazaaris have left the bazaar, not because they're no longer capitalists, but they've actually grown to be members of the grand bourgeoisie. They're very much tied to the regime, and they've done very well in the economic situation despite the hardships, because they have the monopoly over trade and have special contacts with the power elite. So I think the big difference between now and then is the petty bourgeoisie was very much active in revolution at that time. At present, much of the successful petty bourgeoisie has become grand bourgeoisie and is very much part of the regime. The regime is now called Nizam. And if you look at the background of many of the people who are in the ministries, leading figures, political figures, they are rooted basically from the families from the bazaar. So that makes it a big difference. I can say statistically, the regime still has about 20% of the popular support. And much of that popular support would be actually from, I would say, what is often called the traditional middle class, the bazaar. And surprisingly, actually, this petty bourgeoisie has grown since the revolution, because it has also expanded into the countryside. And many small farmers who actually got their farms under the Shah and then were discontented with the Shah, supported the regime, I suspect they still support this this new order and do not want this new order replaced by something which they may not know. So what we could see happening now is the regime is still there. It has some support. And of course, that support is in terms of institution can be seen in the Revolutionary Guards, the Basij. This is part of the state that still holds together. And they have a vested interest in a continuation of the present regime. They're not... there's no sign of actually of the pastars or revolutionary guards or the Basij or the mosques defecting from the regime. So that makes it a big difference from before. Another big difference actually that adds to this is in 78, 79, you had massive general strikes, especially industrial working class supports strikes, especially among oil workers that ground the whole economy to a halt. And it wasn't just protests that brought down the Shah, it was general strikes, a more like 19th century notion of labor movement bringing down the strike. And so far, we haven't seen signs of that yet. You've had some areas, especially in Baluchistan and Kurdistan, that are Sunni. You've had so far there extensive strikes, including in the bazaar. But this has not expanded to the core of the country, the Persian-speaking areas of central Iran. So the protests will, I think, continue because there's economic and political reasons for protests, but the state is not likely to collapse. So what you get is, I would say, a standoff. Now, the standoff has become very much really a clash of cultures, or you can say a clash of discourses. And the language of the protesters is very different from the language of the regime. The regime's whole discourse is Islam and their interpretation of Islam. But you find in the street protests, there is very little talk about Islam. They're not interested in Islam. They're interested in rights, of citizenship rights. And what you find here is really basically a very intense and a very dramatic clash of discourses. And to understand that, one has to look at Iranian history and look at how these discourses arose and how they conflict. From the time of 1900 to the 1960s, the main discourse in Iran politics was actually that of the French Enlightenment, the French Revolution, the rights of liberty, equality, natural rights. And so even conservatives use that type of language for their politics. So if you look at the main political figures in Iran in the 20th century, people like Mossadegh, people like Dehoda, the main intellectual, people even who supported the Shah at one time, Tarizadeh, they all spoke the discourse of the Enlightenment. This dramatically shifted in the early 60s and then fully blossomed in the 70s with a very different discourse, that of Islam. And it came through this idea that anything from the West was bad. And the term that was used in Iran was the term Gharbzadegi, which is often translated as Western intoxication. I would translate it as plague from the West. Because the person who popularized this idea, an originally left-wing intellectual, Al-Ahmad, wrote this pamphlet that became a very popular pamphlet throughout this period, where he basically traced everything he disliked about the Shah's Iran, dependence on the West, the 1953 coup, economic reliance on the West, all of which was legitimate. But then he tied it to everything else he disliked coming from the West, like women's rights, the idea of women dressing up using makeup, corruption, lying in everyday life. Basically, you have a whole list of things he termed as linked to the West, including, believe it or not, the Mongol invasions were tied to this the idea that it was part of the Western disease contaminating Iran. So this was, I think for political reasons, this type of argument became fully blossomed in the 70s with people who were actually quite conservative latching on and using this language of Garbzadegi. Although it originally came from someone from the left, the center and the right and the royalists picked it up and used it. So by the mid-70s, even you find court intellectuals adopting Garbzadegi, people who had studied in the Sorbonne, Third Worldism, come back, are attached to the regime, they adopt freely the idea of Garbzadegi, and anything they didn't like, they said it came from the West. Even you can find that court mystics, Sufis, like Nasr, attached himself to Garbzadegi, saying, well, anything from the West is bad, but in the East, in Islam, you have spiritualism, mysticism, and therefore the East is superior to the West. I know people who were in prison under the Shah when Western human rights organizations came to prison. Their prison wardens would tell the prisoners, don't talk to these guys. They're basically part of Western imperialism, and you don't want to be contaminated by talking to Western imperialism. So this idea of Garbzadegi became very prevalent, became the dominant notion. And one of the reasons the clerics actually adopted Garbzadegi is because they disliked the whole notion of liberty, equality, and natural rights. From there, people, if they had rights, it was from God. And it was, of course, the clerics who interpreted what God's rights notions were and how God had defined individual rights. So once the revolution came, the predominant discourse of the regime was very much that of Islam and rejection of Western ideas of the Enlightenment. In fact, this was considered dismissed as basically destroying Iranian culture, Islamic culture, if you adopted the ideas of the Enlightenment. So in the present crisis, you find that there is very little among the protesters any language of Islam. And the only exception you find, I think, in the protests are in Balochistan, which is a Sunni population. And the local Sunni cleric is very vocal in actually leading the opposition. So he uses religious language. But elsewhere, it's the absence of religious protests is remarkably absent. Another reason I think you would find that there's a shift in the protest discourse is there's a great deal of disenchantment with the Islamic Republic and therefore with Islam. In 78, 79, people supported Islam as a vague notion, idea, cultural identity. But after the revolution, Islam was defined not just as Islam or culture, but with the clerical Khomeini's notion of vilayat-e-fari, which was a new notion, which merely meant that the clerics, the religious jurists, were the guardians of the people, and they should basically have the final say in running of the state. So that the new constitution was set up after the revolution was based not just on Islam, but on the vilayat-e-fari notion of Islam, that the real power, not just clerical judicial power, but political power, institutional power, would reside in the hands of the clergy. So Islamic Republic became a clerical republic. And this, of course, has added to the disenchantment of the protesters with anything to do with Islam. And therefore, the rejection now of the ideas of Gharb Zadegi and return back to the ideas of the Enlightenment. So I think the protesters in the streets may have not read Voltaire or Diderot, they may have Montesquieu, they may not have this intellectual knowledge of the Enlightenment, but they, I think, naturally resort to the right, a question of rights and individual choice, because it naturally fits into their thinking and their desires. And of course, there is this long history on Iranian intellectual life from 1900 to the 1960s, when the dominant discourse was that of the Enlightenment. So you have, in a way, a return to what was the discourse before the 1960s. Interestingly enough, many of the liberal Islamicists or reform Islamicists who were part of the regime until recently, when they started looking at political thought, they gravitated towards actually individual rights and protection of the individual, and came very close to back to the Enlightenment. And they all thought they often that they were creating something new. In fact, they were repeating what Iranian intellectuals had said earlier, but they didn't want to admit that. So they began to reinvent the wheel. But their very notion was, in fact, going back to the principles of the Enlightenment. So I think what you have now is basically an opposition culture that is grounded in the basic ideas of liberty, equality, natural rights of choice, while the state itself is grounded on the notion that the clerics have the right to basically guide and lead the whole country, because the state should be based on the will of God, and the clerics are the people who are qualified to understand what is the will of God, what is the Sharia. So this is going to, I think, lead to a standoff, basically, a permanent crisis, a permanent, I would say, clash of cultures. It might eventually lead to a break in the state, but so far, I think the state has enough class support among the petty bourgeoisie and in the institutions of the state institutions, especially among the Revolutionary Guards, to be able to withhold the opposition. So what I see at the moment is not another revolution, but an ongoing crisis that could possibly lead to a revolution, but not, I would say, right around the corner. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Ervand. And let's go straight to question. Mira asked if you could please repeat the Iranian phrase plague on the West. You did repeat it, but maybe if you could put it in the chat room, Ervand, for everybody on the chat, term that you, in Iranian, that you use, that means that you translate as plague from the West. And as you are trying to do that, let me go to the first question that we have, which is, will it lead to a meaningful change in the course of the protests now if Shia scholars in Iran that oppose Vilayet al-Faqih, okay, it's already in the chat, so you don't need to write it, join the protester, or it's more likely that the current movement will remain neutral and avoid the inclusion of religious figures?
Sorry, could you repeat that? I was trying to spell that.
Okay. Basically, the question is, will the current basically upheaval lead to meaningful change if Shia scholars in Iran that oppose this Vilayet el-Faqih, I'm sorry for my pronunciation, for those who speak Iranian, anyhow, join the protesters, or it's more likely that the current movement will remain neutral and avoid inclusion of religious figures?
A good question, because originally, when the revolution occurred, many of the top religious leaders did not subscribe to Khomeini's theory of Vilayet el-Faqih, which literally means the authority of the jurists to rule. This was not something that traditionally Shi clerics had basically espoused. For them, the senior clerics had the authority, and they used the term Vilayet el-Faqih, that they could supervise people who are mentally unstable, orphans and widowers, like people who would not be able to look after their own affairs. A senior cleric then could have the authority to look after their affairs, like a custodian. But what Khomeini did, he expanded that to everyone, that the senior cleric had authority to be a guide and supervise and a guardian to everyone, whether they were mentally competent or not. So when the revolution occurred, in fact, there were no senior clerics who subscribed to his notion. And in fact, he kept that notion to himself and to his small circle of disciples. And the word Vilayet el-Faqih was not used during the revolution. It was only after the revolution, when they had power and they came to writing the constitution, that suddenly the term Vilayet el-Faqih was produced and the whole constitution was based on Vilayet el-Faqih. In fact, Khomeini's main spokesman in Paris when he was in exile, Ghorbzadeh, publicly stated that he didn't know what the term Vilayet el-Faqih was. He hadn't heard of it before it was discussed in the Constituent Assembly. So it was actually a clever Machiavellian trick of Khomeini not to reveal his cards until he actually had the power. And then, of course, his disciples in the Constituent Assembly drafted a constitution that was based on the whole notion of Vilayet el-Faqih. Once that was done, and any cleric, senior cleric, in fact, who opposed it was basically then denounced as being deviant or being anti-revolutionary. So the other major cleric, Shariat Madari, was in fact framed up as trying to assassinate Khomeini and so on. He was silenced. The other senior clerics basically kept quiet about it. One senior cleric, Golpay Ghani, actually, even though before he had not subscribed to it, he joined because a lot of his students were then basically co-opted into high positions in the new regime. So at present, I don't see any in Iran of senior clerics that would oppose it. Of course, there are clerics like Sistani outside the country in Iraq who don't subscribe to it, but they haven't made it a major campaign issue to actually denounce the notion of Vilayet el-Faqih. So that way, it's become basically accepted in Iran that the Islamic Republic is going to be based on Vilayet el-Faqih. So I don't see senior clerics in Iran actually joining the opposition, because they so far have been integrated or co-opted into the new state system.
Mm. Thank you. The next question deals with what the West should do given the current crisis in Iran. Basically, should it try to get involved? And possibly, if I may add to that question, if involved in what way? Or should we just stay outside and let things play out domestically?
This is obviously the more prevalent question in the diaspora, the idea that the regime is so bad, so weak, so on the verge of collapse, that if it got another push from United States, the whole system would collapse, and you would, as a result, have a flourishing democracy in Iran, as we were promised in other countries, such as in Iraq, in Libya, in Syria. So the promise of an imminent democracy is held as an enticement if U.S. Somehow intervened. The question is often, as you raise, what's U.S. going to do? What can it do? U.S. has already put so many sanctions on Iran and the prominent people on Iran, that the economic pressures are fully there. So, in fact, yesterday, Bolton was asked about this. He wanted more action from the Biden administration, and he basically had no real answer of what U.S. could do, except for more diplomatic pressure. But again, Iran is not is already under plenty of diplomatic pressure. The only thing one could ask is if U.S. pressured all its allies or non-allies like China to break relations with Iran and not to have ambassadors there. But that would obviously be something not feasible. I don't think the Chinese or Indians or most of the countries in the world are going to follow the U.S. if the Biden asked them to break relations. It doesn't make sense to do that. So there is very, very little the U.S. can do short of actually military action. And of course, no one wants to talk military action, but it's often the danger is there that if things actually go out of control, especially over the nuclear issue, U.S. would resort to military action. But no one wants to talk about that because that's basically a topic, taboo topic to talk in the public. But it's something that I think people who are determined to get rid of the Islamic Republic have back of their minds. If necessary, they'd be willing to use it.
Ervand, if I can jump in very quickly as a follow-up to your response. Concerning the military, nobody wants to talk about military action. And if I may express my own view, and I hope that nobody will seriously talk about military action. But we have a recent additional layer of complexity here with Netanyahu's return to power in Israel. Do you think this might contribute somehow to making some type of military response a more credible option, or at least that it would be more seriously discussed in the U.S.?
I think you're right. Netanyahu's coming back. I mean, remember, for him, his main campaign has all election campaigns was always for years that Iran is an existential threat to Israel. And once you say that, of course, then things follow. If it's an existential threat, that threat has to go. Otherwise, you have a repeat of the Holocaust and so on. So when the president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, was denying the Holocaust, this fed into Netanyahu's notion. What I think I see the danger now is that if the regime in Iran feels so confident that it doesn't really need to negotiate with the US about the nuclear issue. You will get an ambiguous situation where they might even throw out UN observers, nuclear observers, in which case there would be ambiguity about what is Iran doing with its nuclear. In that ambiguity, I don't think Netanyahu is going to basically look at the bright side. He's going to then look at the worst aspect of it, and he would move into military action. And the usual, the conventional notion is Israel doesn't have the ability to solve the problem by itself. It could start the problem, then US would be dragged into it. And before you know, then there would be a US military action. And then the US could say, well, we didn't want it, but we were dragged into it. The situation led to that. But I think what is actually dangerous now is the mentality of the Islamic Republic is that they see the shift of power in the world towards East, China. US is on decline, and therefore they feel that US doesn't have the will or the power to do it. US might be in decline, but they should remember that empires that are in decline, if they have the military power, they're just as dangerous as empires on the rise. In fact, more dangerous. And in fact, a recent American ambassador, president said, what's the point of having nuclear weapons if you can't use them? Think about what that means. If you have a Trump back in the White House, he might even think of more than just military action to solve the problem. So it's, I think the mentality of the Islamic Republic elite now is very risky. And the people before who were much more, I think, pragmatic, like Rouhani and Lari Jani, a conservative pragmatist, they were willing to negotiate with the US on some sort of deal, while the present regime thinks they're so confident that it really doesn't need to do that. And that could open up all sorts of risks.
Okay, thank you. The next question is if you can elaborate a little bit more of what was the main motivation of the bazaar, because you spoke earlier about the bazaar Moscow alliance, the motivation of the bazaar to support Khomeini in 1978.
Well, there's a cultural reason. One is, of course, the culture of the bazaar is very Islamic. Traditionally, it has been. The bazaars or the bazaaris are the ones who not only financed mosques, but they were the main people who supported the seminaries and the senior clerics. Senior clerics basically get funds from believers. And of course, ordinary believers don't have much money to give, but bazaaris who have a considerable amount of money were usually the financial backers of the senior clerics, including Khomeini. So there is that cultural link. And of course, there's a family link. Often you find bazaari families send some sons to seminaries to become clerics. But then there was other reasons that the Shah actually politically disastrous decisions he made. In 1975, 76, there was inflation in Iran due to basically the oil money. Prices are zooming up. So the Shah's way of dealing with inflation was to declare war on the bazaars and blame the bazaaris for price gouging. So he sent hooligans into the bazaars, basically threatening the bazaaris. Thousands of bazaaris were taken to court on the grounds of price gouging and so on. So that was the final, basically, a straw that alienated the bazaar. Another factor was that the Shah in the mid-70s declared that there, Iran was going to be a one-party state, and all basically organizations, all citizens had to become members of the resurgence party, his one-party state. And this affected the bazaars, because until then, the bazaars had a lot of guilds, hundreds of small guilds. Each occupation had its own guild. Guild members didn't have political freedom, but they could elect actually guild leaders, guild members. And with the resurgence party, these guilds were now incorporated into the resurgence party. And they were told basically what to do. So it was the backlash to the Shah's war, declaration of war on the bazaars that really forced the bazaars into the arms of Khomeini.
Okay, the next question, in a sense, you have addressed it in the response previously about intervention, but what would the West benefit, if what any benefit might get from intervening in Iran if they decide to do so? Is there any benefit?
Well, I think the question would have been also, you know, what was the benefit of in pouring arms into Syria when the opposition there started? What was the benefit of United States to kill Gaddafi? What was the benefit of invading Iraq? Those questions don't really are not posed for the decision makers. Decision makers have a thing: we have to get rid of this state or this leader, and that itself becomes the aim. If that is done, from their point of view, it's a success, even if the country becomes complete chaos and anarchy in a Hobbesian situation. So from their point of view, you know, the intervention in Libya was a great success. They got rid of Gaddafi. The fact that far more people have been killed in Libya since then, and the country is in perpetual civil war, is not no skin off their backs. It doesn't matter to Washington what happens to Libyans. If the aim was to get Gaddafi, that was a success. So in Iran, it wouldn't be questioned, what is the aim? Is that the aim could be just to get rid of the Islamic Republic so that they don't care what happens after that.
Mm-hmm. Given that the crisis was triggered by the death of a woman, a young woman, Mahsa Amini, how central is the issue of the rights of women in the current crisis? And more, and related to that, what is the support in the general Iranian society about this issue? That is, how important are women's issues in Iranian society at this juncture?
Well, I think they're very important, but you, in the context of the basically Enlightenment notion, it's a question of individual rights, equality, here women's equality, and that women should have the right to choose whether they wear the veil or not wear the veil. And one of the actually most potent slogans in the demonstrations is that the slogan is a play on the main slogan of the Islamic Revolution, except for the last part of the slogan that rhymes with the original Islamic Republic is hijab ehtiyari, the headgear should be by choice, not obligatory. So I think what it is very important in the context of basically individual rights. And interesting enough, many women who wear the veil, they support the question of choice. So it's basically the diehard, I would say the 20%, who feel that this is crucial for Islamic identity to impose the veil on women. I think that much of the even religious women are now basically disenchanted enough with the Islamic Republic to think that women, fellow women, should be able to decide whether they wear the veil or not. But one shouldn't get to the notion that therefore everyone is against the veil. There, I think, still plenty of women who want to wear the veil and they think there's nothing wrong with it. But I think the shift is in that many of them feel that other women, if they don't want to wear the veil, that's their choice. They should have the right to choice. So again, I think it's a very much a change in the discourse. But of course, here it's the protests started with the women's issue of the veil, because again, the regime had tried to tighten their imposition. Under Rouhani, a more pragmatic conservative regime, the people, Basij and Pasdars and the police were not going around forcing women to wear the veil or being very stringent about it. With the Raisi, the situation changed and the regime became much more intransigent about imposing it. And therefore, there was a backlash there.
Ervand, if I may quickly jump again on this point that you raised, do we have any data that we can estimate what percentage of women among those that wear the veil consider that this is a matter of obligation as opposed to a choice, and they are tolerant if, for example, other women choose not to wear the veil? Do we have any sense basically how many from the women that are in the street, even those that are supporting the idea of wearing veil, are sympathetic for these women that are saying we don't want to wear the veil and it should be a matter of choice?
Yeah, it's hard to get figures, but what is actually indicative is some of the YouTube stuff that comes out, the pictures of them. You find the women who are wearing even the long veil, the chador, are intervening to protect fellow women who are not wearing the veil and being threatened by the authorities. So they intervene. You can see that on the screen, that they are actually physically intervening to protect fellow women who are not wearing the veil.
Yeah. Okay. The next question is a follow-up to our exchange about how the reappearance of Netanyahu on the Israel political scene might complicate the situation. Is not a question, but a comment that whether possibly Israel's response might focus first on dealing with the Iranian threat on the border with Lebanon before actually consider doing something more major directly against Iran, that basically make a proxy kind of move in Lebanon as a way of trying to escalate the situation and see what the Iranian response might be. What are your thoughts on that, Ervand?
Well, I mean, if the real problem is Iran as a nuclear power is a threat, as an existential threat, things in Lebanon are not really going to change that. So even if Israel destroys Hezbollah, if Iran is on the verge or does have a nuclear weapon, that's still an existential threat from their Israeli point of view. So I think that would be a distraction, actually, from the real issue.
Okay. And then another question has to do with what could be the motivation today for the bazaar, as culturally the religious people have come kind of disconnected from the regime. What I think this person is trying to get to is what is the possible trigger today that might create problems for the regime from the bazaar?
Hard to see that, because I think so many of the real people in power, the ruling elite, are basically closely connected to the bazaar. Some of the, you know, bazaaris no longer work in the bazaar, have moved out in other commercial activities that are linked with the state. So I can't see what would trigger anything like that. The bazaar, of course, would prefer a more pragmatic Islamic state that had normal business dealings with the outside world. So I think the economic isolation is not helping the bazaar. I don't think they see their future so much with China as Russia, but much more with Europe. And so they would prefer a sort of a more of a, I would say, down-to-earth Islamic government that has normal relations, not necessarily with United States, but Western Europe. But the present Raisi government is, I don't think, interested in Western Europe. So that puts a pressure, but I don't know, like I would call that a triggerer that would cause them to actually break.
Okay.
There have been some things that the regime has done, even before this, it's like setting up large supermarkets, large department stores outside the bazaar. This would seem like an act against the bazaar, and you would have thought the bazaars would have reacted strongly against it. They haven't, I think, in part because many of the shareholders in the new sort of companies outside the bazaar are originally bazaaris themselves. So here you can see a transformation from petty bourgeoisie to grand bourgeoisie. So it's upward mobility from their point of view.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The next question is, could be part of the problem be there, and I imagine the questioner assumes part of the problem that the assessment is that we are not on the verge of a revolution, which is your main conclusion, is more than anything else the absence of a leader, a leading figure like Khomeini, who could have united the different voices now that are expressing discontent against the regime.
Yes, but I think often the role of a leader is exaggerated. If you look at the other major revolutions, leaders were not there at the beginning of the revolution. It's after the revolution that there is a leader and then is called charismatic figure. I mean, Lenin was not known in 1916 or early 1917. In the French Revolution, who could you say is Robespierre was someone, a minor lawyer at that time. So you don't necessarily have some great figure at the beginning of a revolution. In Iran, it was more complicated because the early protests didn't start with Khomeini people. It started with university students, often by liberals or leftists. And then as it escalated, you had the emergence of Khomeini in the clerical structure. But at the beginning, it wasn't, there wasn't a revolution because Khomeini made pronouncements in 1976 or 75. So I think it's a leader arises much more after basically the crisis is full scale. And then you talk about charismatic figures, but actually in the early part of the revolution, it's usually better not to have a leader because that could alienate other people.
Okay. The next actually question slash comment is that instead of confrontation, why the U.S. and its allies don't try to put more emphasis on negotiations and dialogue?
A good sensitive issue. I think Biden came in with the basically a promise to go back to the Obama deal, which was actually a very good deal. Now, some people blame Biden for not quickly basically settling that issue. I'm not privy to what was happening behind the scenes, but I could argue that, in fact, the delay was not so much from the Biden's point of view, it was from the Iranian point of view, that they were not interested in a quick deal. For a number of reasons, they were basically waiting for a new election. Rouhani was the president who was in favor of a new deal, but he was not in charge of the negotiations. Khamenei had made sure that basically there would be no serious negotiations until the new president came in. And the new president was engineered as a person who really was not that much in favor of the new old deal. So I think the delay came much more from there rather than from the West. But clearly, I think the Biden administration would have liked a deal at the beginning. And of course, the Europeans were very much in favor of it. Even the Russians were in favor of it, of basically settling the issue.
The next question has to do with the protest and its ability to effectuate some kind of a change or at least some gain. If it does not lead to a revolution, if somebody wants to offer some guide to the young people that are demonstrating in the street or some suggestions, what would be the next step in this series of protests to at least gain something more than what actually to gain something, because at the moment it seems that they are hitting a brick wall?
Well, I mean, so much depends on the people making decisions in Tehran. They could very well decide that a way of taking the wind out of the opposition is to give concessions that would not challenge their power, but it would be symbolic and relieve the pressure. So, for instance, going back to the Rouhani period, where the authorities don't enforce the headgear rules, that could actually relieve that. Of course, the diehard opposition is saying that we don't want reform, we want revolution. So that's not. But if there is enough, I would say, skill or pragmatism, they have that choice. But so far, all the signs are that the regime feels that if they give any concessions, they'll have to give more concessions. So the only way to deal with the opposition is a diehard opposition. In fact, a couple of days ago, one of the diehard editors of the new main newspapers was asking the rhetorical question, why weren't the Revolutionary Guards using proper bullets? His complaint was that there was not enough people being shot in the street. So that at the moment is, I think, the tendency to go.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that question is quite broad. What would be the best solution for Iran at this juncture, economically, politically, and socially?
easy. return to the Obama deal and the U.S. actually abiding with the Biden deal of lifting the sanctions from Iran, maybe not necessarily from the Iranian leaders, but of course from the whole economy.
I think we have time for one more question or comment before we adjourn. Anybody? Okay, then let me ask a quick question to you, Ervand. There is, as I'm sure you are well aware, quite a fascinating literature on what role diasporas can play politically in the countries in which they are situated in shaping that country's policy towards the countries that they come from. And there are some studies that say that diasporas can be effective if they say things that the leadership of the country already wants to hear, or they're consistent with how the leadership of the country in which they live feels they should approach their country of origins. There are some others that say that in some situations, diasporas can really actually change the mind of leaders in the countries that they live in and affect substantially the policy towards their own country. Now, from your experience with the Iranian diaspora, what would you say its influence is? Is it the case that they will hear the Iranian diaspora voices, the administration, depending on what administration is and what are their priority, or there is a possibility that the Iranian diaspora can really affect the orientation of American foreign policy towards the country?
Well, I think that the people in the diaspora who are basically part of certain organizations, whether it's the monarchists or the Mujahideen, they have their own agenda. They want the destruction of the Islamic Republic, thinking that once that's done, they will then have a better opportunity to come to power. But I think a lot of people, responsible people in the diaspora, their job should be to tell the administration or the American public actually this, the, what they see as the real situation. So if they see that, you know, it's much more complicated, that the regime is not going to be replaced by some full-blown democracy, then they should be honest and basically espouse what they see, how they assess the situation. So the notion often now in the diaspora is that, well, you know, 100% of the Iranian population is dying to get rid of the Islamic Republic, and therefore any the U.S. should not deal with Iran because that would be betraying the whole of the Iran. I think that's a disservice to the actual Iran. The job should be basically to explain the complexities and that the fact is that it's not a regime that's about to collapse, and therefore the U.S. should not really mess around in this situation. I think one thing we've learned from the Iraqi experience was, if you go back to the Iraqi situation, so much of the diaspora, the Iraqi diaspora, at least the organized vocal, was adamant that if U.S. invaded and got rid of Saddam Hussein, there would be a democracy, full-fledged democracy. Mm-hmm. And it was very hard at that time to say, no, that actually Iraq was a much more complicated situation. And you were then basically denounced as being pro-Saddam Hussein if you basically warned of any caution. And the similar situation could arise with Iran, that basically the diaspora dominant voices are that the U.S. should be aggressive in getting rid of Saddam, of getting rid of the clerics.
Yeah, yeah. No, and that's what I mean. One of the examples I had in mind for this was actually the case of the Iraqi diaspora prior to the invasion of Iraq. And one interpretation was what you said. The other interpretation is that those that they were listened to because there were some people in the inner circle of the Bush administration, like Paul Wolfowitz, that they had already made up their mind that they should invade Iraq no matter what. And the diaspora voices basically reinforce their argument.
Yes, and I think you're right. They had decided on their own. Yeah. Of course, I think Israel came in there. So they went to people like Chalabi and Makia, yeah. And they knew that they would say the things they wanted. To give you an example, actually, in the run-up to the Iraqi war, I was turned my Middle East course at Baruch into a course on Iraq. So we spent the whole semester studying Iraq, and we used Makia's book about
Republic of Fear.
Republic of Fear. And, you know, once you read that book, you realize that Iraq was not on the verge of democracy, yet Makia became one of the most vocal people in the United States calling for invasion on the grounds that the invasion would lead to democracy. So there's a lot of politicking that goes on.
Well, thank you. Obviously, thank you, Ervand. Obviously, the conversation could go on, but we have reached the end of our session. I'm sure that you will all join me in thanking very much Ervand for his very thoughtful and insightful remarks on the current situation in Iran and the way that he handled our numerous questions and queries. And I very much hope that those of you who join us late, let me repeat, we have a couple more public events this semester, one on November 5th, the other on November 8th. The first one will deal with discussing the experience of a French lieutenant colonel in peacekeeping operations as part of our year's theme on the quest for dignity in the security sector. And on November 8th, we're going to have our event on...
December, Professor.
Yes. And on December 8th, we're going to have our event on the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And please stay tuned for more information. If you are not on our listserv, please contact Martina and she will put you on our listserv for our events so that you can follow what we're doing and join us for these events. Thank you all again. Have a nice afternoon, evening, morning, whatever time zone you are in and you are joining us from. And Ervand, thanks again very much. We appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Martina, can you stay for a second?
Sure.